indeed. Mr. Vice Chairman, the organizers, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, I wish to thank the Global Compact Network of Poland and the Warsaw Stock Exchange for inviting me to speak this morning, and in particular for inviting me to ring the bell for gender equality a bit later this morning. It's a really great honor for me, and thank you, Mr. Miskowski, for the kind words about my country. At the global level, Denmark has a very special relationship with your organization, the UN Global Compact. We see the UN Global Compact as a global partner in achieving the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. Government cannot do this on their own. We need to work with the private sector to achieve those goals. And this is exactly where the UN Global Compact comes into the picture, because it's about 9,000 companies in more than 170 countries. They're part of this compact, and the Global Compact of Poland is a proud part of it. And as you all know, one of the Sustainable Development Goals is to achieve gender equality and empowerment for all women and girls. Providing women and girls with equal access to education, representation in political and economic decision-making processes will fuel sustainable economies that benefit societies at large. Governments can do a lot, but without the partnership of the private sector, this goal will not be achieved. And this is exactly why we are gathered this morning at the Warsaw Stock Exchange. For most people, including myself, the stock exchange is a very simple private industry. This is where stocks and bonds and shares and listed companies are being traded. We can see it happening as I speak. And prices are governed by the brutal forces of supply and demand. And in the popular image, a stock exchange is also a very male-dominated industry where traders in white shirts are working on the trading floor. I don't know if you have a trading floor, it's probably gone, but now they're sitting behind their computers. But all the books and movies about the financial industry have main characters, but also female characters, but normally in supporting roles as wives or assistants or lovers, or both. This is all fiction. In real life, it's very different, and we just spoke before the conference about the progress that you're making here in Warsaw. Still, I think that today's venue is a very appropriate location and a good example of the way that the Global Compact is working through advocacy strong partnerships with private industry. So let me take this opportunity to thank the Warsaw Stock Exchange for hosting us this morning. I see this as a very strong symbol of your commitment to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. Now, I've been invited to say a few words about the economic benefits of closing the gender gap. This is, of course, a very important question. It is, however, also important to bear in mind that from the very beginning, the struggle for gender equality has had a very strong political and social dimension in the Nordic countries. It involved the struggle for decent wages and working conditions for women, as well as access to full political rights. It was actually Finland that was the first European country to grant women the right to vote in 1907. Denmark followed in 1915. But in other words, the struggle for gender equality was driven by political motives, not because of economic benefits associated with gender equality. But whatever the motives, it's clear that the Nordic countries have achieved tremendous progress in terms of gender equality. Scandinavia has one of the highest employment rates for women among the OECD countries, and it's actually Sweden that tops the ranking with a female employment rate of 83%. In Denmark, it's 72. Here in Poland, I think it's about 58, a bit lower. You can also take a broader view on gender equality. This is what the World Economic Forum is doing in the annual gender gap report that was the one that you were also quoting. And it measures equality based on a more comprehensive set of parameters, economic participation and opportunity, education and attainment, and political empowerment. The gender gap index has the advantage that it doesn't matter whether rich or poor, it simply measures the gender gap. And again, the Scandinavian countries are topping the list, whereas Poland is in the middle of the global ranking, but they're moving ahead. Now, what are the reasons why Denmark and the other Scandinavian countries have achieved this gender equality? It's not perfect, we're still working on it, it's work in progress, but we have achieved a lot of progress. so far. The main reason why Denmark has made major progress in gender equality is that there has been, from the very beginning, a strong cross-party political commitment for generations. And if you look at our legislation, it says that the purpose is to achieve gender equality in all functions in society on the basis of women's and men's equal status and to counteract discrimination. Now, this is a political and ideological ambition that is shared by almost everybody in Denmark. I don't think you will find anyone who would disagree. But apart from the political and ideological reason, there's also a strong belief that gender equality actually pays off. There's a growing awareness that there are huge economic benefits from improving gender equality. That applies, as we all know, at the company level. If you compose teams that are diverse in terms of gender, age, and ethnic background, etc., you simply get more efficient teams. Nobody knows that. That applies in particular when it comes to complex tasks like innovation, decision making. And if you exclude women or make their participation difficult or burdensome, you simply get less diverse input and ideas. And that means suboptimal decisions and thus less efficiency. So there's no doubt that equality pays off at the company level. But gender equality actually also pays off at the national level, because the level of gender equality that we have in Denmark is not least based on easy access to daycare, generous rules on maternity and paternity leave, and support for families with children. I think that's the key to gender equality, and that's our experience. But this comes with a price tag. We pay high taxes in Denmark, as you all know. And sometimes the question is being raised, can we really afford this? Does equality pay off at the national level? To answer this question, the Danish think tank has recently conducted a study based on macroeconomic data from the OECD. They look at the relationship between GDP per capita on the one hand and the share of GDP spent on family benefits, for instance, daycare, child support schemes, and maternity and paternity leave. And the underlying assumption is that this kind of expenditure is conducive to equality. The study shows that there is a positive relation between the economic level of the nation and the expenditure on family benefits conducive to equality. Those nations that have a high level of expenditure on family benefits, like the Scandinavian countries, also affluent countries that have high economic growth for a long time. They also have a high level of female participation in the labor market. Because how can you afford true economic gains if you exclude half the workforce? So it's tempting to conclude that investing in equality also pays off at the national level as well. So for us, gender equality has a strong political value in itself, but it also brings with it efficiency, economic growth, and prosperity. Companies that invest in equality and women in leadership positions tend to be more profitable. Similarly, nations that invest in gender equality tend to be more affluent. But now, of course, the big question is our experience with gender equality, does that have any validity here in Poland? And first of all, I need to stress that gender equality is for the Poles to decide, not up to us. But we are very happy to share the experience that we have. And how can we do that? In my opinion, the best way is to build on the extensive business contacts and people-to-people contact that exists already between Denmark and Poland. There are about 500 Danish-owned companies in Poland with about 50,000 employees. And most of them, if you look at it, they use the same standard operating procedures to support gender equality in their Polish operations as they do in Denmark or anywhere in the world. Most of the Danish-owned companies here in Poland nowadays, they have a fully Polish senior management. There are no Danish companies here anymore. But they're just as keen on furthering gender equality as Danish senior managers are, because they know it pays off. And in preparation for today's conference, I talked to a number of the general managers of the Danish companies here in Poland, and they basically highlighted the same elements when I asked them, what are you doing to support gender equality in your daily operations? First of all, they all said that there is a strong focus on making sure that childbirth and maternity leave is not setting back female staff or setting back female staff in their career. And secondly, there's a very strong focus on a work-life balance that supports gender equality and makes it possible for female staff to combine career with family life. And thirdly, there is a strong focus on policies and tools that support gender equality by building awareness of discrimination mechanisms and the tools that can be used to further gender equality. Measuring gender equality is important in itself because what gets measured gets done. The results have been very positive. The Danish retailer Jysk, might not all be familiar with them, but they are leading in the bed line and mattresses industry. They're global, they work all over the world. Here in Poland, they have about 210 shops and sites, if you're looking for them. 60% of their shops in Poland now have female managers. Why? Because it pays off, because otherwise you cannot retain your trained staff once they have achieved a certain level. So it's actually good business to have female managers. But like in most companies, the higher you get in the hierarchy, you find fewer and fewer women. That's the same in Houston. But the most important thing is that there is a policy and the efforts are ongoing to implement that policy. So let me conclude by thanking again both the Global Compact Network and the Warsaw Stock Exchange for inviting me this morning. I look forward to ring the bell for quality later on this morning. And I know this is just a simple, but as you know, ringing a bell can have a dramatic implication. Think of the Liberty Bell in Pennsylvania State House where it rang. It was heralding American independence. So ringing the bell here also will probably have less far-reaching consequences, but I hope it will take us a little bit closer to achieving the sustainable development goal of gender equality and empowering all women and girls. Thank you very much for your attention.